tall, fair, beautiful, or whatever. It's always fair. Joining me now is Jaishree Sharad, who, of course, is known as the skin doctor. But more than that, she's somebody who's sort of persistently tried to change the way we think about ourselves and our well-being. It's also telling about how obsessed people are about wellness and health. And to me, that's a good shift. It's important to go beyond what is their glowing skin to perhaps deeper and understand where the root cause lies. I'm a huge fan of a total care approach to women's health and delighted to talk to Dr. Jaishree Sharad. We've been timeline followers for some time. Wonderful to have you here. Talk to us about your book and your plans and why now?
Thank you so much for having me, Shaili. First of all, it's such an honor finally to see you, and I hope to meet you soon in person. So the book, you know, this is my third book. It's called The Skincare Answer Book. And the first two books were more, text-oriented. But this one happened during the lockdown because I was doing a lot of Instagram lives when I saw that, you know, people were just in search and they were all wanting a lot of knowledge on skin. There was more awareness and also what was happening was, you know, a lot of people who were not really specialists were giving out knowledge. And I had a lot of patients who were coming online with a lot of rashes because they've used some random creams that they saw on Instagram. So I started doing these lives. And then I started doing these ask me stories where I would say, okay, ask me any question. And people would ask me questions. So then the editor got in touch with me, the editor of Penguin. And she was like, you know, why don't you write your third book and it could be just a question answer thing. So I compiled all these questions that would come to me every time on my Ask Me series and I just answered them. So, you know, that's how the content fell in place. Like it would be skin types and moisturizers, sunscreens, cleansers, acne, hyperpigmentation. So it's a very easy read and that's how the book happened.
Let's talk about what is it that we are getting wrong about our skin? We have this obsession in this country about fair skin. You know, we've sort of been very, very particular about trying to do something about it on the surface. Tell us, where does that stem from and how is that conversation around us changing?
So I think it's, it all began when you had all the Aryan invasion and the Portugal and the French invasion. And then, of course, British colonization, where the fairer you were, the better jobs you got and you were allowed in better societies. And, you know, it just sort of entered into every nook and corner of the country. And we've had patients who actually come and say, you know, our daughter's not fair. She's not going to get married. You look at all these matrimonial columns. They always talk about, you know, fair female, tall, fair, beautiful or whatever. It's always fair. Now, it's not just towns and villages, it's also big cities where the fairness race is big. You look at media, you look at every possible, you know, every other ad, you know, you have fairness soaps, you have fairness serums, you have fairness creams, you have, you know, fairness masks and gels, and you just name it, it's all about fairness. And, you know, there are tablets, there are topical lotions, and then, of course, there are chemical peels, there are lasers, and then now there is this glutathione injection, which everybody wants to take, you know, whether it's for an interview or whether it's to get into movies or whether it's for some modeling or whether it's for, a job or even marriage, for that matter. People want to be fair. And it's quite sad because melanin that we have, Indians, you know, we have more melanin. We have type 2, type 3 skin. And melanin protects us from ultraviolet A and ultraviolet B. And it prevents skin cancer. So it's actually a blessing and we should just embrace it. And there are some organizations like Dark is Beautiful who are now making that move and trying to change certain things. I also am aware that Dainik Bhaskar has now banned matrimonial ads which say fair, so which is a very big move. And I think most of the other papers and even on the digital platform, I think they should follow. And I also know that a few, you know, media personnel and few ad agencies are now looking at more dusky models. And I think that's a great move. So it's all about embracing yourself. You need, okay, it's great to have flawless skin and, you know, radiant skin, but color should not matter. I think all shades of brown are beautiful and we need to embrace that.
Let's, let us deep dive a little bit on these injections that you talked about. The reason being, you know, we, particularly women, would spend nearly all of their money on trying to get something that appears like a fad and then deeply regret it a few years down. So I was just wondering, like, what are the one or two things that you think today are those fads that everybody should stay off?
I think fairness creams, most certainly, because some of them have mercury, some of them have heavy metals, some of them have steroids in them. And they will eventually damage the skin. You know, they'll cause atrophy or thinning of the skin and sensitive skin, acne, telangiectasias, all of these. And the other thing is the, you know, the overdosing of the glutathione injections that's happening now. Glutathione is a very potent antioxidant. It's actually very good when taken in normal doses. Anything in excess is going to have certain side effects, right? So we don't know. It's a very new molecule. It is given for, you know, liver toxicities and cirrhosis of liver and all of that, but about 600 to 1200 milligram. But the way people are overdosing and taking 5,000 milligrams and 10,000 milligrams and taking it every week just to become fair, and, you know, because glutathione reduces the melanin content in the body, that is appalling, because we don't know if 10 years from now it's going to have an effect on the kidneys, because there are certain studies which do say that it can cause renal failure if you overdose yourself. The other thing is, there is melanin in our retina. If melanin is getting reduced from the body, obviously not just from the skin, it's because you're putting it IV, it's going into your blood, it can reduce melanin in your retina. So over a period of time, is it reducing your vision? We don't know. So you've got to take these two with a pinch of salt.
Great. You know, as somebody who's kind of heard from different people on the credibility you bring through the experience you've had, as well as your training as somebody who's a skin doc, how conscious are you that what you say will be weighed with a great deal of, you know, trust? And so when you are talking to people about their skin, you know, how critical does it become for you to navigate that carefully, put your personal belief and their expectation on a balance?
So, you know, back in the day, it was easier, I must say that, Shaili, because people would just blindly believe. But there was also not so much awareness. Today's day and age, of course, apart from Dr. Google, there's Instagram. And, you know, people are already well-read. They already know about all the active ingredients. You know, they know that there's a retinol and a niacinamide and a vitamin C. And so if I say, listen, you don't need vitamin C, there's a question mark, or there's a look on the face saying, are you sure? Or if I say, listen, this is not the time for you to use retinol, there's always, like, at least 3 out of 10 will say, you know, doc, are you sure? Because they're all aware and they're all reading. And, you know, a little knowledge is always a little bad, right? So it does get a little difficult. But at the end of the day, when you speak science and you explain things, you know, more scientifically, I think they get it.
So, you know, when one looks at, let's just talk about a little bit of a to-do list. And the reason I say that, because I know that every woman who's listening to you and I talk, she wants to know, where does she start? How many friends of mine must have called me and said, oh, you're not yet on your skincare routine. And I'm like, no, I'll keep it for a little later. I don't have the time. But I think maybe, well, it's partly true. It's also partly I'm just lazy. So for all of us who are just lumps of complete laziness, talk to us about what makes a good skincare routine?
You know, I don't believe that you need a 10-layer glass skincare routine. I'm a person who believes in minimalism and holistic skincare. And it's not just me, most dermatologists and science talks about it. So cleansing, of course, all of us are doing. But it's also important to moisturize the skin, because as we age, the barrier protective layer of the skin gets depleted. And, you know, the ability of the skin to retain moisture reduces. So moisturizing, especially, you know, after the age of 30, 35 is a must. Sunscreen is something that everybody should be using 365 days, whether you're indoors or outdoors. And that's something that people don't do, either out of lack of awareness. A lot of people say, oh, we don't step out. And a lot of people are lazy. And a lot of people also feel that sunscreens are very greasy and sticky. Now, you have newer sunscreens, which are water-based, which are very lightweight, and they are broad spectrum. They're great. So that last part is out. When you are indoors, and if you have daylight, like, you know, right now I have a lot of light coming into my room, you have at least 70% of ultraviolet A penetrating through the glass. So you are still getting exposed to light. So it's not about sun, it's about ultraviolet rays, and it's about visible light and blue light. Now, this kind of light from my laptop screen and from my ring light is also like a lot of blue light, which can harm the skin over a period of time. So you do need a sunscreen even indoors. And, you know, the process of aging starts from the time we're born. I mean, we're growing up, and as we're growing up, the body is aging, the skin is also aging. So it's always good to start using a sunscreen, you know, right in your teens or maybe even earlier. So I always tell people that, listen, if you're really lazy, or if you're having a bad day or a tired, you know, a very hectic day, the least you can do is just use a sunscreen. You know, after your shower, just use a sunscreen. That's something that you should do. At bedtime, again, cleansing, removing makeup, however tired you are, and then using either a moisturizer or an anti-aging cream, whichever suits you. So this is what the basic skincare should be. Then if you are a little more like, okay, you know, you want to do a little more, you can add a day serum, a night serum, depending on what your skin requires. And don't forget to apply the moisturizer and the sunscreen on all the exposed parts of the body, because, you know, if you take care of your face and don't take care of your neck, the neck gives away, and also your hands and feet. And the other thing is, the skin under the eye is very thin, so always moisturize the skin under the eye.
Let's deep dive into that a little bit, particularly trying to understand if there is a connect between perimenopause and the journey to menopause with skincare, and what is it?
Yeah. So perimenopausal symptoms, you know, definitely they will be seen on the skin. Hormones and skin are interconnected, and the skin itself is an endocrine organ. Endocrine organ is where, you know, you have all the hormone regulations happening inside. So around this time, the skin tends to get drier. It tends to lose more moisture. Okay. The collagen starts to degrade at a much faster rate. The elastin fibers. So collagen and elastin, these are fibers which form the framework of the skin. And they give the skin the firmness. So you begin to lose that. The degradation is very rapid. You know, like sometimes you'll see people say, oh, you know, up until 6 months ago, my skin was fab, and now suddenly it's just degrading, and suddenly I can see lines, and suddenly my pores are looking dilated. That's because the rate of degradation is rapid. You know, it can happen overnight. And that's because of the hormonal changes that your body is going through around that perimenopausal phase. So dryness, blotchy skin, skin tends to get hyperpigmented. So pigmented patches, melasma that you see as a butterfly pigment on the face, you know, fine lines, pores getting more prominent, hair loss. That's a big, big issue. People tend to start losing hair because the hair cycle slows down, and the hair in the growing phase, that is the anagen phase, gets into the shedding phase, that is the telogen, and people start to lose more hair. There's also something called female pattern alopecia, which is hormone dependent and genetic as well. So all of these changes will happen, you know. The other thing that also happens perimenopausally in some people who are also genetically predisposed and have very oily skin will be acne. So people who've had acne in their teens will probably again have acne around the perimenopausal time. And there are also a set of people who have never had acne, but suddenly, you know, around 47, 48, they're breaking out. So that is also possible because of the estrogen progesterone imbalance that happens.
Got it. So you mentioned, you talked about hair loss, you talked about potential acne and various other things. Just trying to understand that when all of this happens, and we know this, I mean, like, you know, beauty has always been this whole element of confidence, right? People feel underconfident if they don't feel pretty, or they don't look pretty, or they have like a burst of acne, or they're losing hair or balding or whatever, despite knowing that we're all going there in some form or the other. How much of your time is spent getting people out of those confidence lows, and how deeply is skin connected to depression?
I think pretty much, you know, we are actually now looking at a curriculum which talks about, which teaches medical or dermatology residents about psychodermatology. So we're looking at one entire aspect, because stress and skin are interrelated. Because the moment you're stressed, you know, whether you're you know, upset about something, or a pimple is bothering you, or pigmentation is bothering you, or hair loss is bothering you constantly, you know, your hormones do change with that, because your cortisol hormones will increase. And gradually I have seen people getting into depression just because of this, because there's FOMO, or there is, you know, I don't look good. My Instagram pictures are not good. My friends are looking fab. I am not. This happens to youngsters as well as to more mature people as well. And, you know, a lot of times I find that I am sitting and counseling my patients rather than just giving them some medicines. You know, gone are those days when we would just write a prescription. It's all about, you know, looking at what is behind this physical appearance. And a lot of times it's a vicious cycle, you know. And so they are depressed because they have acne. And because they're depressed, they're getting more acne. So it becomes like a vicious cycle. And it's increasing. It's actually increasing. People are, they feel so underconfident. There is so much of psychological trauma when they have acne, or when they have hyperpigmentation, or if they're balding early, or there's premature, you know, hair fall, premature aging. There's a lot of, you know, a lot of people do end up with depression. It's quite sad, but we need to handhold them. We need to also guide them. Sometimes I've actually sent them to therapists, and it's very interrelated.
You mentioned, you talked about social media, and it's amazing how we're discussing social media and skin and its impact on it. I don't want to kind of make this a simplistic equation. So why don't you unpack it for us?
So there is a good side to it, because people have become more aware. You know, they understand the importance of probably routine skincare. You know, what are the different kinds of serums? How important is it to use a sunscreen? They know about actives now, as I just said some time back, which people never knew. We were using retinol. Retinol was discovered in 1947, and suddenly everybody's talking about retinol. So that's the good side of social media, right? Where the awareness has really increased. It's jumped. And not just females, even men. In fact, people from all genders, and men particularly now, are looking at skincare. And that's a very positive, a very vibrant change that I see in men when they come to the clinic, and they're no longer coming to us for allergies and eczemas and atopic dermatitis and stuff like that. They're coming for routine skincare. So sometimes they walk in and there is like one pimple, and then you sort of say, okay, this is what you're supposed to apply. And then they say, no, but we want a full routine. When you're done with the routine, they say, but doc, can we do something more? Can we come once in a month for some treatment? So all this is thanks to social media. Now, the negative side of it is that, you know, youngsters are always in competition. They want more likes. They want their faces to look flawless. They want, you know, sharp noses. They want big eyes. They want big lips. So all of that, boys want a well-defined jawline. They want a broad chin. So all of that is also happening. And then, you know, people, as I said, people who suffer from acne or suffer from, you know, these little patches and uneven skin tone, they're constantly under pressure that, you know, oh, I am not good enough. So There's some amount of insecurity. And then there is also looking at your favorite actor or your role models, or, you know, Bella Hadids and the Gigi Hadids and all of them, and Kylie Jenner. These are role models these days. And people, you know, youngsters constantly want to look like them. They want to ape them. So there is a negative to social media also. Filters, you know, and then they come to you with filters and say, well, I want my face to look like this. So it's very difficult to make them understand that, look, you know, you are what you are and you've got to embrace your features. It's okay to tweak a little bit something and to, you know, especially if you're a little more mature and you want to look more youthful. But always remember that less is more. And there are certain things that you just don't need. So yeah, you do have positives and you do have negatives of social media.
Such a pleasure chatting with you, Jaishree, with the deep honesty that you talk about this and the passion with which you do this work. Thanks so much for joining us and good luck with your book.
Thank you so
much. All the best. I want more people to read it so they can not just fix skin issues, but know how they should approach skin without stereotypes.
Thank you so much, Shaili. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure. Such an honor being here. And I hope to see you soon.
Done. All right.